Let's head up to Brisbane now, and joining us live is Jim Chalmers, the Shadow Treasurer. Jim, good to see you. Thanks for your time this morning. So we've seen some pretty interesting numbers that emerged yesterday. Unemployment surged to 5.2%. It was at the end of lockdowns, though. So are you expecting that to be as bad as it gets?
Well, I hope it is, Pete. Good morning. Look, I think yesterday's unemployment number was a pretty brutal reminder that this recovery that Scott Morrison and Josh Frydenberg talk about is not a recovery for everyone. 46,000 people lost their job in the last month, 141,000 the month before that. And that is a brutal reminder that this recovery that we all want to see, we all want to see the economy get better, we all want to see the jobs market get better, but for a couple of 100,000 Australians in the last couple of months alone, the reality is a very different and very brutal one.
Yeah, and you talk about those job losses, but the bit that surprises me the most, Jim, is that businesses, at least the ones I'm talking to at the moment, they can't get staff. So it's not like there aren't jobs out there.
Yeah, there's a real double whammy in the jobs market at the moment. I speak to a lot of employers right around the country. I was in Mount Isa and Cairns during the week. And if there's one kind of defining failure, one defining symbol of the last 8 years of economic mismanagement, it's that we've got around 2 million Australians who can't find a job or can't find enough work. At the same time as we've got all of these skill shortages and these jobs going begging around Australia, there is a real mismatch. And it's a reminder once again that the recovery will be patchy, it will be different for different people, it will be uncertain. And that's why in the Prime Minister and the Treasurer's rush to kind of give themselves a big pat on the back, we want to make sure that those hundreds of thousands of Australians who've just lost the job aren't forgotten.
Can do capitalism. What do you think?
It's just one slogan after another. And it's becoming this kind of pathetic parody of itself. You know, one day after another, this new slogan as the Prime Minister tries to slither out of this, you know, quite pathetic persona that he's created for himself. You know, for 8 years now, for example, you know, he's been one of the key obstacles to doing something meaningful about cleaner and cheaper energy. So all those jobs and opportunities and all that investment's gone begging in the meantime. So judge him on the last 8 years of being an obstacle to meaningful action, not the last 8 days of pretending that he cares about all of these sorts of things.
Well, you got some company in the kitchen there, Jim.
I'm sorry about that, Pete. They're watching the Lion King. It's getting a bit rowdy.
It's not a problem. I do want to ask you about inflation. These staggering numbers that are coming out of the US, 31-year highs, 6% alone in the US. We're not doing too badly here at just about 2% at the moment. But do you fear that a storm is coming? And if so, how much longer can we hold on?
Yeah, I wouldn't describe it in those terms, but certainly, you know, you talk to a lot of economists around the place and they're keeping an eye on inflation. The big question on inflation is this a temporary thing, which is about the kind of pressure on the supply chains that businesses rely on to create their goods and services, or is it something more enduring and something more damaging? I think the other thing to understand, and working families understand this as well as anyone, is that two of the big pressures are actually petrol prices. People are getting absolutely smashed at the bowser,
yeah.
And construction costs if you're trying to get a reno done or something like that. And so those are the pressures that working families feel. And the other most important thing, I think, inflation is obviously a crucial measure in the economy, but what actually matters is whether people's wages can keep up with that inflation. Mm. The government in their own budget says that real wages will go backwards, that the price of everything will continue to rise and wages won't rise as quickly. And that's why working families in this country are falling behind under this government.
So, and something that would help is migration. Obviously, as you know, it's dropped to zero because of the pandemic. So do you believe that there needs to be a bigger priority, a faster priority placed on getting skilled migrants and getting international students out here as soon as possible? And what level would you like to see that?
Oh, look, I think now's our big opportunity to think about the best version of our migration program. While the tap's been turned off, we should be spending this time working out what's the optimal number of students, what's the optimal number of skilled migrants and all the rest of it. But again, you know, the government's had 8 years to fill some of these skills shortages. It kind of beggars belief in lots of ways that we haven't trained enough Australians for enough of these vacancies. Migration will always play a part in that story. I'm a supporter of migration. We need more people here in this country, but we need to make sure that we're training our people for the vacancies as well. The government hasn't done that. So when the tap does get turned back on and when the migration program does get back towards full tilt. We need to make sure it's the best version of that. We're doing a lot of thinking about that behind the scenes, Christina Keneally and others. It's one of the most important things that we need to get right as we emerge from this pandemic.
Okay, just finally, my colleague John O'Lee, he's been reporting this morning that the government wants to form a bipartisan debates commission ahead of the next election. I mean, Labor would be desperate, I'm sure, to do as many debates as possible to get your message out there. So you'd be supporting this, wouldn't you, Jim?
Oh, yeah, we want the public to see the contrast between these leaders as much as possible. And so we will work with the government in a bipartisan way. We've proposed this independent commission before. We want to see it work. We haven't seen that letter that's found its way to Jono yet, but when we do, we'll work through it and we'll engage constructively. But I say this as well, Pete. From my kitchen in Logan City, I challenged Josh Frydenberg to multiple debates about the economy, the future of the economy, and his appalling record and this government's appalling record over the last 8 years of wage stagnation and insecure work. The Treasurer and the Alternative Treasurer should also have multiple debates. I will debate him wherever we can, whenever we can. We want the economy to be central to this contest, and he should have to defend 8 years of economic mismanagement and the fact that if this government is re-elected, there will be more attacks on wages and super and Medicare and renewables and all of the rest. That should be central to the campaign. The Treasurer and the Alternative Treasurer should also have multiple debates.
Okay, there you go. The challenge for the Treasurer too. Jim Chalmers live for us from Logan City this morning. Appreciate that, Jim. Thank you. We'll talk to you soon.